Greetings, everyone, and welcome to the computational methods session here at CMOS. I'm Christopher Subic. I will be one of the co-conveners of the session. Michael Dunphy is here, and he will be taking the second half of the session. According to the stopwatch, we should be beginning in about -3 minutes. I will be the timekeeper for the first half of the session. I will mark 12 minutes for the speakers to wind up in short order. We'll take the intervening 3 minutes between talks for questions. Let's see. All right. First up is Nick Eno with, let me go back to it to make sure I have the title exactly correct. With generative adversarial networks for super resolution and downscaling of wind fields. Please take it away, Nick.
Great, thank you. Okay, my name's Nick, and I'll be, I'm a master's candidate at the University of Victoria, and I'll be sharing some of my ongoing deep learning work with UVic and also at Environment Climate Change Canada as an SWEP student. So I'll just first start off by introducing something called super resolution, which comes from the computer vision field. And this focuses with enhancing the resolution of imaging systems. And this is very closely aligned with the downscaling of gridded data. So far, deep learning has achieved great success at this so far. So just as a description of what the problem is, I have some coarse images or fields here, and the goal is to produce high resolution counterparts using super resolution. So the deep learning framework that I'm using is something called a generative adversarial network, or a GAN for short. And I'm using a flavor of GAN called conditional GAN, or SRGAN. And I won't go into too much detail for how GANs actually work, but as a quick overview, they consist of competing convolutional neural networks, which are a type of deep learning model that are optimized for two-dimensional or images. So one of these is called a generator, and the goal of the generators is to produce fake-looking images. These fake images then get combined with real images and are provided to an additional network called the critic or the discriminator. And the goal of the critic or the discriminator is to provide an output indicating on the realism of that field, so whether or not it looks real or fake. A lot of my work will be focused on, so they're each trained using their own objective function. And a lot of my work will be focusing on the objective function for the generator. So the objective function that optimizes the generator. It consists of two terms. One is the adversarial loss, or the adaptive loss term, which comes directly from the critic, like I said. And another one is something called the content loss, which is a super resolution specific loss term, which is just the pixel wise mean absolute error, mean squared error. So GANs have been used in climate field downscaling so far, but there's a few shortcomings. So the biggest is that they focus on idealized pairings. So the coarse input to the GANs are really just artificially coarse and fine scale images. So this forms a very idealized pairing between the consistency between the coarse and high resolution fields. They typically only focus on single regions, and there's been a limited amount of work that incorporates new advancements in GAN architectures. So for my work, I'm interested in wind fields. And the reason for this is that they're highly variable and they're strongly influenced by topography. And so from a computer vision perspective, this poses a very difficult problem for the generator and the discriminator to solve. The climate models I'm using are ERA Interim, which is a global reanalysis at 80 kilometers, which is on the coarse resolution side. And then on the high resolution side is WARF, which is a convection permitting model at 4 kilometers. And the motivation behind using these three models is that WARF is synchronous with ERA Interim, so they're concurrent. WARF is driven by ERA Interim boundary conditions and initial conditions. And then although WARF is allowed to freely develop its own climatology, it's kept dynamically consistent at coarse scales with ERA Interim through spectral nudging. And so there's large scale consistency between the realizations between ERA and WARF. And so that's important. So kind of how you can view the GAN super resolution here is as a deterministic regression using climate fields. So I've identified 7 coarse covariate conditioning fields that correlate with wind. So obviously the zonal and meridional wind. I'm also providing the land sea mask, surface pressure, surface roughness length, topography, and convective available potential energy. And so each of these pixels in the coarse resolution version is replaced by 64 pixels in the high resolution case. So these get provided to the generator. And it's important to note that the generator is multivariable. So for a given realization, it'll produce simultaneously zonal and radial wind fields. Those then get provided to the discriminator and the training proceeds. So an additional consideration that I'm doing to try and improve my work here is something called frequency separation. And this comes from the computer vision field as well. And the idea with frequency separation is that you take your original image or your original field and you decompose it into a low frequency version and a high frequency version using some filter. In my case, I'm using an average 2D pool kernel, which is just a localized average moved across the field. And then you take each of these fields that you've split and you delegate those to terms in your objective function, building on the successes of those terms. So for the kind of the smoother representations, I delegate these to the mean absolute error. And then for kind of the more fine spatial detail information, I delegate that to the convolution neural network because it's optimized for those tasks. You can also manipulate the frequency cutoff by changing the size of your average kernel. So for smaller kernels, you get more detail in your low frequency version. And then with larger kernels or 13 by 13 kernels, you get a more smooth representation. And then that kind of has the opposite effect on the high pass version, where you have more overall frequencies in your high pass and less overall frequencies. So these are the configurations that I'm using for frequency separation. And then one other baseline I'll just introduce is just a convolutional neural network baseline. And the idea here is I've taken the same GAN architecture, but I've just removed the critic or the discriminator entirely. And so I'm optimizing the generator network just using the mean absolute error. And the reason for doing this is to see what impact the discriminator or what impact the adversarial loss actually has on the results. The domain I'm interested in is WARF. So this is a realization of WARF. I've chosen three climatologically unique regions. So one is the western region here, which is dominated by strong topographical features and mountains. The other is the central, which is mostly land dominated with some lakes. And then Florida, which is a mix of land and sea, but it also has lots of convection. So it has lots of these highly variable mesoscale convective systems that are represented in WARF. So those are the three regions that I'm interested in trying this on. The results take about 2 to 3 days to train per GAN, depending on the GPU that you use. I'm just using a consumer grade GPU, and I do a roughly 80 to 20% split between my training set and my test set. And then all the results I'll be showing are from the test set unless explicitly labeled otherwise. So this is a training evolution plot of Florida. So the way to interpret this is on the y-axis is just the mean absolute error. On the x-axis is the epoch or the number of times that the networks have seen the data set. And the first thing that I'll point out is that if you look at the test set, you can see that the models generalize quite nicely and there's not a lot of overfitting occurring in any of the models. There is some minimal overfitting that occurs after about 200 epochs. You can kind of see this as a characteristic slight U shape in each of these figures, but it's minimal. And then if you look a little bit closer at these plots, you can kind of see this ranking of each of the models. So the convolutional neural network in red actually performs the best in the mean absolute error sense, followed by the purple, which is a 5x5, 9x9 in green, 13x13, and then the no frequency separation in black. So that's kind of an interesting ordering, which I'll get you to keep in mind as I show the actual realizations. So here is a representative realization from the data set. On the left here is the ground truth. So this is WARF ground truth for the Florida central region and west coast. And then on the right here is error in terms. So you can get an idea of the sense of the how large the resolution gap is between the high resolution and coarse resolution. And everything in between, sandwiched in between, are all my models. So you can actually see just how realistic the fields the GAN produces are. The kind of first thing I'll point you to is if you just look at the convolution neural network baseline here, you can see that there are high spatial frequency or detailed information that's in the GANs that isn't provided at all by the convolutional neural networks. And I owe that just to the fact that the adversarial loss is sampling more of the overall variability of WARF. It's sampling it better than the mean absolute error can. Then if you look a little bit closer at each of these individual fields, you can see that there's kind of this truncation in the high spatial frequency information. You can particularly see that in these mesoscale convective systems in Florida, where the quality kind of seems to be degradative as you move from left to right. And so kind of the way that I've organized this plot and the way I'm interpreting it is that as you apply frequency separation to the fields, you actually end up delegating a smaller portion of your frequencies to your adversarial loss. And then you also end up delegating the larger portion of your frequencies to the content loss or the mean absolute error. So that kind of explains some of the ranking that we're seeing in the training evolution. And then this is just a climatological statistical plots here showing each of the regions of my testing years. So this is for 2000, 2006, and 2010. And really what this shows is that all of the models actually look pretty good if you compare them to the ground truth. The downscaled models do all look quite nice. However, if you look at the convolutional neural network baseline, you can see that in the GAN cases, particularly in the central region, the lakes are more systematically represented in the GANs than they are in the convolutional neural network baseline. And so I'm also interpreting that as just that the adversarial loss is helping represent these fine spatial features better because of the convolutional neural network's discriminator. So I've kind of presented this these kind of conflicting viewpoints. So one is the qualitative interpretation, which to my eye, looking at many of these fields, the no frequency separation GAN seems to represent the full range of frequencies a lot better than the other GANs, and especially the convolutional neural network case, but it's been challenging to try and quantify this a little bit better. So in order to attempt to quantify this, I've decomposed the fields by looking at their kinetic energy spectrum. So the way to interpret these figures here is towards the left-hand side of the plot are kind of the low frequency, large scale structures. And then towards the right-hand side of the plot is the high spatial frequency information. And the thing I'll just point out here is that green is ground truth. And so the closer the lines are to green, the better. And you can see that in this plot here, there's a divergence between the convolutional neural network in red from the ground truth. And of course, we saw that with our eyes that the convolutional neural networks weren't representing this high spatial frequency information as well. And this is systematic across each of the regions. And something that this kind of way of looking at it is more sensitive to this. And then this is the same plot. I've just cropped it to see the frequency separation cases a little better. So the interesting thing here is if you look at the purple line, which is the 5x5 kernel frequency separation case, and then all of the other frequency separation cases, you can actually see how it follows the convolutional neural network for some time before it reaches some frequency threshold, and then it breaks off and joins the ground truth more closely. And so I'm kind of interpreting this as kind of the frequency cutoffs that I've chosen by applying the smoothing kernel to the fields. And you can see a ranking here.
You're at 12 minutes.
Thanks. The main point behind this plot is just to show that the black line here, which is no frequency separation case, follows most closely to the ground truth. And so this means that the no frequency separation case is representing the wharf across all of the spatial scales best. And then to just wrap up here, so the GANs are performing quite nicely for these non-idealized coarse and fine resolution fields. The GANs introduced very realistic fine scale spatial variability that I've confirmed with the kinetic energy spectrum. Something I didn't really emphasize, but something that I've also shown is that the Wasserstein GAN, the flavor GAN that I'm using, is extremely stable, which is important. And although frequency separation didn't quite yield the improved convergence that I was hoping for, it does reveal some interesting things. So rigid metrics like mean absolute error and mean squared error don't really capture the quality very well. And the physics and form analyses can help to break to improve that. So with that, I'll just leave up my future work slide and acknowledgements and take any questions.
Okay, there is one question in the chat from Renee. If you'd like to ask it, or rather, if you'd like me to read it out, that's also okay.
Oh, I can ask it. I mean, I'm really glad that you're not using the upscale, downscale versions because they drive me nuts. But have you Have you tried modifying your own input data? Because you could do a lot of feature engineering to the data before using a GAN on it. You could sharpen bands or exaggerate edges.
Yeah, I haven't really modified the input too much. I'm not sure. I haven't really modified the input too much. Something that I'm interested in trying is I'll just leave it at that. I haven't tried modifying them too much yet, but I'm interested in the role that the content loss has, because the content loss kind of guarantees a consistency between your output fields for a given realization, which isn't necessarily always true across climate models. And I'm also interested in incorporating stochasticity so that instead of a deterministic regression, I'm also outputting an ensemble instead of a single realization. So there could be work to feature engineering. GANs are so hard to train that it's hard to search the space for the optimal configuration of inputs.
Okay, thank you very much to our first speaker. Up next is David Landry, who will be presenting on neural networks involved in statistical post-processing of weather forecasts. Good, your screen sharing's working, and there's your full screen. Okay, I'll let you begin.
Thank you. Hey everyone, thanks for being here. My name is David Landry. I'll be talking about a way to try and reduce the amount of data needed to bootstrap a post-processing system using a toy-ish example that I would present. A few words about me. I'm a senior data scientist at the Computer Research Institute of Montreal. The center as a whole is mandated to support economic growth through technological transfer in computer science and AI in general. But we also have a great experience in geospatial and climatic data through works such as the climatedata.ca portal, which we're involved with, and also the data analytics for Canadian Climate Services analytics platform that supports research. If we do a little overview of how post-processing was done using neural networks in the past, the first big work was done by Stephen Rasp in 2018, demonstrating the use of multi-layers perception, so a very small and maybe less sophisticated way to use deep neural networks, but which did work to perform post-processing at stations, namely in Germany. Then this was transported to grid using CNNs in 2020, and more recently, the transformer architecture, which we'll be using here, has also been applied to ensemble forecast. The difference in their case is that they used the attention dimension over the members of the ensemble, whereas here the attention will be over the station, so spatially instead of member-wise. So the problem that we're studying here is how to, because I knew from experience that starting the post-processing models or training the linear models can become tedious in operational context because of the large amounts of data needed. And that made me think of transfer learning. So how could we use domain adaptation to maybe try to use the training data from a larger subset of stations and then apply it to new locations without needing a whole retraining? So perform transfer learning from one to the other. And deep neural networks are a good candidate for such a task. So for this, we'll be using the transformer architecture. The original paper is here in the right. It's called Attention is All You Need. And so the intuition behind these systems is that people in language translation tasks were looking for ways to better model distant relationships in sentences. So if you want to translate languages like German, for instance, you need to be able to connect the word at the beginning and the end of a sentence. And traditional neural networks that worked on time series can have difficulty doing that. And what came out of this is a type of architecture that's really able to build connections between nodes, almost like it's learning a multigraph. And I hypothesized that learning a graph over a stations of network would enable us to perform better domain adaptation, because the new station that we add into this space would only have to kind of fit, find where they fit in the ensemble of existing stations. And from there, it would be easier to perform post-processing on them. So this is another slide that kind of explains the intuition behind it. In the language translation tasks, transformer networks are able to connect in a subsequent layer the word it to the animal more strongly using embeddings. And we're going to be trying to do something similar with stations here. So our goal is to, as I've mentioned, kind of try and build a graph or a multigraph that would establish relationship between existing stations and then add a new set of stations on top of it, which would, because they integrate an existing model, they would need this data, or at least we hope so. I mentioned here that for the fine-tuning part of it, we freeze the upper layers of the model, which I explain a little bit better later. So here's the architecture. So I wonder for a while how to best apply this architecture, the transformer architecture, to a weather problem, because the original task was a language translation, so some adaptations were needed. But overall, we replaced the notion of token, which is a vector that represents words. And these tokens are replaced with, first contextual token, which will describe the current step you're on or the current model version you're using and the overall context. And then we will use other tokens which represent the stations themselves. Half of the representation is used by a fixed station embedding, which describes how, in general, the station reacts to post-processing or how it should be post-processed in general. And then there's another part of this embedding that is comprised of the dynamical features. And the input part on the right is the only part that is not frozen when we perform this bootstrapping or fine-tuning task. The rest of it is learned also, but on our larger data set. So the experiment we devised for this is to post-process GDPS directly on Metar station. So a task where we know there's post-processing to do because of the coarse resolution of the input model. And we target Metar station. There was a Metar data archive on the web, which I could scrape easily. So that's how we created the observation data set, which was turned out to be very hard. You guys probably know already about this, but I found out the hard way, and I'm still not super confident in the way I treated this. I wish there were more observation data sets available, which were treated by experts, but still. For this task, we target surface temperature at first. More target variables are incoming. And we compare two models, a simple linear model, MOS, and then the transformer-like deep neural network, which I propose here. Now, to perform transfer learning, what we did is separated the stations in two sets. The first one, which I call the reference set, is our larger base data set, which we want to train the whole network on. And then the goal is to take as little data as possible from the stations in the bootstrap set and see how they react to post-processing, how well we can perform post-processing using more limited amounts of data. Temporarily, the data set is separated like this. This is the GDPS data I was able to acquire through the public data services of Environment Canada. So only 2 years, this sort of data is hard to acquire, and I think it underlines the importance of reforecast for machine learning tasks. So I'm not working on the GEFS model, which has 20 years available on the internet. So it makes this kind of task a little bit easier. And here's the separation between the bootstrap set, so the target set, and the larger training set. So in blue, you have the reference set, which contains approximately 1,000 stations. And then to select the bootstrap set, we performed the furthest point sampling. So we picked the first point at random, and then pick the point that was the furthest to it and the furthest to these two, and et cetera, to reach around 200 stations. So what I found is that when we look at the root mean square error of the raw GDPS model, it's a little bit higher on the bootstrap set, which is to be expected because it overrepresents more sparsely populated areas. And then if you use the whole data set, attention networks perform about on par with linear models. I will underline, though, that if you have enough data, then attention, it seems, becomes favorable for post-processing tasks. But the real figure I was targeting was here was how can we perform fine-tuning by training on the reference set and then having a more limited amount of data for this red set of stations. And what I found is that it does indeed perform a little bit better. So for reference, we can get about a 5% improvement using only 30 days of data. So you'll notice that the first part of this figure is a little bit noisy. So it's I wish I could, in future works, make this training framework, this bootstrapping procedure, the fine-tuning procedure a little bit more robust so that we can get better metrics. But assuming the worst case, we still get around like 5% improvement using only 30 days of data for the new stations, which is interesting. And it's able to do that because it can connect these new stations with the nearest stations or analogous stations that it already has internalized in training. And then as you enlarge the training set to 90 and then up to 700 days, then the linear model performs about on par with the attention model. But then again, this is for a limited amount of data. So when you add more stations and have something that is a little bit more populated, then attention becomes better again, from what I found. And on a more introspective note, so what I did here is that I looked at the learned station embeddings, because in the input data, I don't provide any geographical information, right? I want the attention network to be able to learn station embeddings, which among other things is able to connect stations that are nearby with one another. And so on this plot here, what I did is I took the embedding from Montreal Airport, and then I looked at the similarity of this vector compared to the vectors, the fixed vectors associated to all of the other stations, and I found that indeed it looks like qualitatively it looks like stations that are closer to the Montreal Airport have indeed a closer vector to Montreal Airport's vector, which was encouraging. This plot isn't perfect, but we didn't want it to, because we know that there might be local biases or some other information inside the stations about the stations which make them different from Montreal Airport, even if it's nearby. This is one of the things we wanted to be able to capture with the attention networks. As far as future works go, well, first I want to make the fine tuning more robust and find ways to make it more reproducible. So far, some of the training runs, like if you started 10 times, maybe 2 times out of 10, it's not going to converge. So this is very important for the credibility of the method. And then the other step is to go on GEFS12. I think these first results are encouraging. So now by enlarging the data set, I'm hoping we can do even better fine-tuning tasks, maybe by first training on the larger GEFS and then fine-tuning on the GDPS data set that I already have, and in that way, improving the post-processing there. Add more variables. There's no reason a priori where we can't target multiple variables at the same time. And we do know from machine learning theory that adding more tasks might improve the quality of their learned representations all over the board. So sometimes solving multiple tasks at the same time improves all of the tasks, which is counterintuitive. And then taking these transformers and bringing them to grid would be also interesting, but then we have computational issues because these networks are quite memory intensive. So finding how to do that, we will have to look at once again at the computer vision literature, just like Nick did. How am I doing on time? Is there a few?
You are at 12 and a half minutes, so you're perfect.
Okay. I had a few more, but if they come up in the questions, I can
okay.
Bring them out.
All right. Thanks. Thank you very much for your talk. It looks like we have one question again from Renee in chat. So if you'd like to take that away.
So hi, David. Super interesting. I've also used attention and been able to refine my NLP, my classification methods, but I'm always a bit leery of attention because it has so much human subjectivity in it. I mean, you're making judgment calls when you parameterize the model. So I liked your future works, but have you reflected on the induced subjectivity in with attention?
Yeah, so obviously in any like machine learning model, and especially the deep neural networks, like the architecture design is, as you mentioned, subject to human hypotheses. So the way we go around this is by using the classical like train validation test method. So I have a robust list of experiments where I try different architectures and then perform multiple training runs using multiple hyperparameters configuration. So I played with the number of blocks, the number of attention heads, and multiple other parameters, and came to these results that I have here. So obviously there's a human input in the architecture, but maybe I can even propose a counter argument because like for the linear model I present, for instance, they're very primitive, and I'm sure somebody that's more expert than me could bring the score down to the levels I've showed here, like for the attention. I'm sure it could be improved upon using expert input, right? By making maybe manual relationships between the stations, or finding ways to initialize the model where there's missing data, and using expert judgment here. What I thought was nice with the attention network is that this kind of network of station was built automatically. So I never provided anything about latitude, longitude, or anything like that. And the network was, well, qualitatively, at least I couldn't quantify it yet. I haven't found an experiment for that yet, but at least qualitatively, it seems that the network is able to connect stations between themselves. So I thought that was interesting because if, I don't know, the use case I had in mind for this was a new construction site in a remote area where the official forecast might not be super well tuned because it's remote from the closest station or scribe point. And then this I thought could be at least a hypothetical use case. So if you don't have an expert that can connect manually to like the nearest stations and take local factors or climatologies into account because it doesn't know how to do that, then you could rely on such method. But then you have to trade one expert to another, right? You have to trade one weather expert for one neural nets expert. So,
okay, thank you. I hate to cut you short, but we also need to move on to have a hope of sticking to schedule. thank you for the very interesting question discussion, though. Up next is Rick Danielson, who is going to be speaking about a framework for complete measurement models. And see your head there.
Okay. Let me just see if that, just making the choice here. Can you see this?
Okay. Yes, there the slides are up. Okay, thank you. Begin when ready.
Great. Yeah, thanks everyone. On behalf of Jing and Hui, Joelle, Will, and I, welcome to a framework for exploring systematic error in a quantitative complete measurement model. So I'm adding a few words here in the title, but so basically, let me start by describing the lineage of the measurement model by which I mean regression model that we introduced at last year's meeting. we'll follow Pearson's emphasis. Now, this is Pearson 1902, so I'm going back a little bit, which is a little off topic for this session, but I think we can catch up to speed a bit. But the emphasis there was on the genuine aspect of correlated error. And I think we can extend that emphasis to the entire model here, hopefully. And in a hydrologic model observation context, I'd like to just review a playful controlled experiment that was placed on GitHub in advance of the Ocean Sciences meeting in March. So that was, it's a new repository and I'll do some self-advertising there if you don't mind. But again, this year, I would like to acknowledge Graham Dunn, who is a leading British statistician and whose insights were both challenging and instructive. So the measurement model will employ a co-located sampling strategy that's denoted by the colored dots moving left to right. And of interest is the linear and nonlinear and lack of association between some less familiar uncalibrated platform or instrument and one that is more familiar, like an opportunistic whale sighting, even if that whale sighting in the lower right might be a little less precise as an unfamiliar to some, perhaps, as a reference. But in any case, it's notable that a wave-like sampling is possible for large data sets that are gridded in space and time. And last week was the 50th anniversary, as it turns out, of the Statistical Society of Canada. And that featured work, important work on COVID-19. But one of the take-home messages from that meeting was that other scientific disciplines don't necessarily have the same experimental modeling freedom that geophysics does, or that our community does. And I think that's pretty important. It has been, I think, an advantage for us. So this especially in terms of this trichotomy of nonlinear, linear, and lack of association is an unusual way to describe individual model terms. But its heritage can be traced to an introduction by Pearson in 1902 of three observers as a means to identify the errors of each of them. And the geophysical focus on Pearson's approach happened to reemerge in 1988 in the form of triple co-location. And that continues to be the term that people use nowadays. But that helped to motivate this model, this wave-like model. Except that instead of three independent observers or three sets of red dots aligned vertically up on top, there's a method of moment solution allows us to identify solutions to this model using just two data sets, but with predictive samples, quote unquote. Obviously, what this model effectively is constructed out of is very similar to what the triple collocation model has, which is an alpha and a beta term and T to capture linear association between all these samples. And in addition, for the so-called predictive samples, there's symmetric first order autoregressive errors for each data set separately. And then the errors are also collocated in epsilon, correlated in epsilon. And this epsilon without a subscript is a term that's not always introduced in the canonical measurement error model literature. But geophysical theory, like the equations of motion, would allow for a nonlinear relationship between any two samples, like B and C, or more nonlinearity in between C and U, perhaps. But the key question is, how can a wave-like model like this accommodate nonlinearity in what is otherwise a set of linear relationships? So the short answer is perhaps that we'll try and broaden the interpretation of error. And let's begin with C, the calibrated measurements, and T, the simplest signal model. So if we ignore noise for the moment, then it seems reasonable to characterize geophysicists as attentive to unresolved scales when developing their numerical model, say. And similarly, statisticians are attentive to limitations of the linear model. So when we equate measures and model, a geophysicist might subtract representation error from C, and a statistician might add equation error to T. Now, equation error accommodates nonlinear signal in the relationship between C and U. And representation error accommodates scales that are in C and not in U. So although we write these errors separately, we also need to ask to what extent geophysicists and statisticians are concerned with the same error. So in the literature, it's rare to find a separate equation error or representation error term included in the uncalibrated measurement equation. An accommodation of representation error in both C and U is sometimes seen as a debate, but perhaps it's more like a ripping the band-aid off situation, in that if we want to accommodate representation error in C and U, we might need to accommodate equation error in C and U as well. That refers to the overlap that is not defined here. But including a separate equation error in U couldn't be justified alone because there is a linear relationship to T here. C and U are equally justified in having an equation error term on the far right. So even, you know, their numerical values may differ, of course. And moreover, there seems to be no other way for this model to incorporate the impact of hidden or confounding variables. So all, the only measures are C and U, right? And these may be impacted differently. So that's another aspect. There's a third justification I would submit that is more practical because it relates to the model solution. But in any case, the interpretation of error in terms of signal is challenging. And in 2017, thankfully, Graham Dunn provided a five-line response, which of course took a few years for me to absorb. But basically he said that equation error could be mixed in with other errors and equation error could be correlated. So if we carry that advice forward and place measurements on the left-hand side and model terms on the right, then we have linear association, correlated and uncorrelated equation error, and representation error, which is uncorrelated by definition. And all these signal components are needed to describe C and U. So even without the introduction of noise or measurement error by some standard definition. And without loss of generality, measurement error in C and U can be divided among the signal terms on the right-hand side, or it can be written as its own term as we wish. But since we're interested in terms that can be evaluated numerically, let's just follow Professor Dunn's advice and let correlated equation error stand by itself alone and combine the uncorrelated equation error and representation error terms into a separate term on the far right. And this is the core of our wave-like measurement model. So this form makes explicit a term epsilon that we could call an error cross correlation term, but its interpretation is nonlinear association. And although signal defines our interpretation of terms, again, we can conceive of spurious components in each term. And to illustrate the point, there's a more formal attempt at deriving such an equation on the archive. That's short, if you want to take a look. Anyway, returning to Professor Dunn's question of practical implications, there's no doubt about a different interpretation because measurements and variance and covariance, they all have nonlinear components. And so by extension, Pearson correlation also has a nonlinear component. And it turns out that distance correlation, which is a relatively new metric, also resolves nonlinear association. However, comparisons online don't necessarily involve all forms of nonlinearity that we might be interested in, such as the impact of a confounding or missing process or variable. So what we opted to do is construct a measurement model, OSSI, to allow new ideas to be tested. And I'll just describe that in the context of hydrology. So by random samples of uniform and Gaussian distributions, we can simulate anomalous river height or river slope at 10,000 well-separated reaches that have been observed hourly since the turn of the year 1900, if you can imagine such a data set. The anomaly is such that there is only variability between a day and a year. And for each river reach, we generate about 1 million samples of a uniform random Gaussian distribution, uniform random distribution, bandpass filter that to get a time series in this range of -0.2 to 0.2 on the left. And so from the middle of each of such a time series, we take just 5 consecutive samples, and those define the slowly varying signal in both C and U, and C and U are perfectly calibrated. This experiment takes up the challenge of trying to simulate a confounding impact in the presence of measurement error. So two types of perturbations are employed, and both are designed to be resolved by a lack of association between C and U. One type is Gaussian, where the perturbations are added to U in varying degrees, and the other type is what we can call Spearman, a random reordering of signal in U that might appear to treat two river reaches as exchangeable, but is meant to simulate a confounding impact without imposing a systematic relationship between C and U. And these idealized experiments are as simple as we can make them. First, we've made C and U perfectly calibrated. We've also
you're at 12 minutes.
Okay, thanks. Spearman perturbations are applied to the order in U, and the relative to Spearman perturbations are applied to order in U are applied to the relative order of all predictive samples. So the earlier and later samples remain predictive of U, as you would expect. So the Gaussian Spearman perturbations might appear to be similar in these lower and upper panels, but by design, Spearman perturbations impose no turbulent variations across STUVW. And the question becomes whether we can distinguish Gaussian and Spearman perturbations using a model. And here I'll just add that the Spearman perturbations can be said to perturb U alone because they're a perturbation of relative order. So they could be applied to U, you described U or C, but it follows that if we consider C to be unperturbed and equal to the baseline signal, U alone is perturbed, then it's only predictive samples involving STUVW and not ABCDE that access both Gaussian and Spearman perturbations and hence distinguish them on that basis. So it turns out that there's more than one model solution by the method of moments and using as few as six sample sets. So ABCDEU or CSTUVW, each set yields six variance equations, 15 covariance equations, 17 unknowns. Analytic solutions exist for 15 of these unknowns. This is all on GitHub, by the way. The remaining two unknowns are the variance of T and beta U, and those are the two key parameters. And we'll just propose to minimize the distance of each solution to these two parameters using minima pathways in each of six covariance equations that involve the variables other than U and C. And together with a constraint that variance is positive, as expected, we refer to that as an equitable accommodation of weak or imperfect constraints. An exercise in consensus building, if you will, and demonstrations down below. So the two solutions happen to be directly comparable to ordinary and reverse regression solutions that are analytic. But in the case of our wavelength solutions, STVW and A, B, D, and E, they provide subsamples around U and C. And that allows us to estimate Gaussian error with the analytic solutions don't. So because we would assume that these samples don't exist in the analytic case and that there's no error in the variables bracketing U or C. So just to wrap up, the linear and nonlinear and lack of association results can be expressed as normalized U and C variance budgets. And we'll average these results over 100K simulations in this case. But by design, A, B, D, and E, they're poorly employed. They don't sample any Gaussian perturbations. This model solution is just consistent with ordinary regression, which assumes that C is error-free. And in the case of STVW, these are well employed in sampling Gaussian perturbations. Model solution functions as an upper bound on beta U, but provides a better bound than reverse regression. So the lack of association terms in C and U allow us to distinguish Spearman and Gaussian perturbations. And we suspect that all three association terms or categories are needed to do so. Autocorrelate, let me just also conclude, hopefully that's okay. There's a session tomorrow in the Marine Environmental Response section that features a comparison between Pearson and distance correlation. So hopefully I can attract some of you there, but that'll incorporate some linear and nonlinear parts to all this. Thanks.
Helps to unmute. Thank you very much to our speaker. Unfortunately, we're running just slightly over schedule. So I see Dominic Brunet has a question in chat and I invite further discussion there. But next we have a poster associated with this session that will be described in more detail tomorrow afternoon, but the schedule gives us about 5 minutes for a advertisement for the poster. Is Genevieve here to advertise it? Oh, good, good.
Let me just share my screen.
Yes, you can grab the screen sharing. Rick, I think you need to unshare your screen. You still have control over it.
I'm trying to. I don't see the screen anymore.
Can
I? Yeah, there we go.
Up there. There we go. Okay.
You see the presentation?
Yes, I see the presentation.
Okay, perfect. So I should be pretty quick. Hi, my name is Genevieve Trifolius, and I'll be giving you just a very quick overview of what we'll be discussing more in detail tomorrow on the poster presentation. And our poster is Experimental Development for AI in Weather Using Hydra. I am currently a data scientist at the Computer Research Institute of Montreal, working together with my colleague that presented before, David Landry. We use the Hydra library. So Hydra library is an open source Python library that allows for an actually very easy integration of a configurable execution pipeline. It's very flexible and it's also very lightweight, which makes it ideal to use when you have a lot of experimentation and running multiple experiments quickly and efficiently. Just describe really quickly the advantages of using Hydra for your experimental pipeline. It has a modular configuration system, which allows quick additions of new configuration for your experiments without changing the source code. It also has the ability to override your default arguments and your configurations directly in the command line. It also has the ability to run multiple jobs from one single command line. And you can run either locally or on an HPC cluster, such as Slurm, for example. And also has the ability to log your experiments in centralized file location, meaning that if ever you do want to replicate previous experiments, you have already all of those experiments logged with every configuration that was used. So to conclude, it's very extremely useful pipeline, extremely useful tool to use. It helps accelerate the development of the experimental pipeline. It also has the ability to run multiple experiments much faster. And we actually have a concrete example of the Hydra pipeline that was done for the winning entry of the WMO S2S AI challenge done by our colleagues at the CRIM. So I hope to see you all tomorrow to dive a little bit deeper in our presentation about, on our poster on using Hydra in your experimental pipeline. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That sounds really interesting. I hope that everyone involved in data science shows up for the poster tomorrow. Okay, and for the second half of this session, my co-convener, Michael Dunphy, will be taking over. So you can unmute. Yes, you have done that. Please take it away.
Thanks, Chris. So our next speaker is Kota Endo, and the topic is robustness of the parameterization of subgrid scale wind variability on sea surface fluxes. So I see you're unmuted and I see your screen, so take it away.
All right, so I would like to present today the robustness of the parameterization of subgrid scale wind variability on sea surface fluxes. So what are we trying to do here? Now, suppose that we have a geographical region with this illustrated wind field, and we would like to represent this in a numerical model. Now, if you were to compute this, if you were to represent this field in a model grid box, you would have a Mariano and zonal wind vector that represents this region. But you'd see that if you were to compute the mean zonal wind and the mean Mariano wind components in this region, then these vectors would vanish. And so the norm of your vectoral wind components will be zero. We also see that your mean wind speed in this region is non-zero. And so this gives rise to a missing part in the wind speed, which in the representation. And so why is this important? Well, the wind speed in a numerical box in a model is important for computation of sea surface fluxes. And so here we try to represent this wind dependent part of the flux with this normalized representation that depends on the wind speed to a power that depends on the specific flux that you're interested in. And here we see this is equation one. And then the error process, the difference between the true flux and what you see in your numeric model, we will quantify as this error process epsilon. Now, from previous works, we know that this error process can be characterized with this form that depends on the resolved scale flux and the precipitation, which is a proxy for the subgrid scale convective process that adds to the error, plus a stochastic part, the residual represented as psi in this equation for sure. So to modify this and parameterize this epsilon, we are in need of this, the true and resolved fluxes in the region that you're interested in, but would be preferable if this could be done with observational data. Now, such data that's a scale that's appropriate for this kind of work doesn't exist. And so we use high resolution numerical model output. To do this, we take the numeric model output and then find the wind speeds at the fine scale and take the norm of that to compute the fine flux. And then the coarse flux is computed by choosing a larger resolution and then computing the mean zonal wind and mean meridional wind in that coarser resolution grid box and then find the norm of that to represent our result of scale flux. The fine resolution model output we use for this work is the output that's been submitted to the Diamond Initiative. And this set of high resolution global numerical model output allows us to extend the previous work, which used a regional model in a 90 time scale and extend it to a larger array of different models and different geographical regions. In particular, we choose these regions that's illustrated here, the Pacific Warm Pool, two regions in North Pacific, and a region in the Southern Ocean. And we explore how robust this regression is, both in geography and different underlying models. And back to the statistical model here, the regression has two parts to it. It's the deterministic parts that's in the square brackets here, and then plus the stochastic residual. So first, we'd like to look at whether this deterministic regression is robust. And so what we're interested in here is whether or not you can generate a regression model using the output from one numerical model and apply it to a different numerical model where you have no a priori reason to expect it to work and see if it gives the deterministic part of the epsilon that you would expect if you were to generate the regression coefficients from the output of the second model and apply it to the second model. And so the results here show that the deterministic part of the regression is robust. And so you can take the regression that's been generated from one numeric model and then expect it to work reasonably well when you take it to a different model. Similar procedure can be done for different geographical regions. And again, we find that there's high correlation across different regions for the models that we use here. Now to the stochastic part, the psi. This field in space and time is it's a distribution, but what we're trying to do here is to quantify its relationship, the relationship of psi in one location at one time, and see how it relates to psi at some different location at some different time. And in particular, we use this awareness matrix, which is quantified by this roughness parameter gamma and three length scales. And if this field is just a random field, then we would expect this to be uniform in space, but that we don't observe. And there's two possibilities to this. It's either a genuine feature in the fields that we're seeing here, or sampling variability. And to see if it's sampling, we can check the correlations for different models in a similar fashion here. And what we find here is that this spatial heterogeneity in psi is a genuine feature. So what does this mean? Well, it means that the regression model has some room for improvement. Despite this, we can still say that this error process, the difference between the true and coarse plots, can be done in a robust manner. And there's little sensitivity that's observed when you take the regression obtained from one different model and take it to a different model, or for different geographic regions, or even for time periods. And therefore, we find that the study regression model appears to be a reasonably robust parameterization for operational models. And so we conclude that operational parameterizations of the wind-dependent part of C surface fluxes can be constructed in the same fashion for different regions and for different numerical models. That is all. And so I would like to take any questions.
All right, many thanks. So do we have any questions?
I have one, I suppose. With the reasonably good coefficients between different models, do you think this is capturing similarities between the models themselves, or do you think it is more related to capturing how these models imperfectly describe reality? For example, if IFS and FV3 have a high correlation coefficient, is that because they are having similar idiosyncratic errors, or do you think it's because they're both modeling reality at about a 0.94-ish level of correlation?
Well, the models themselves are not very similar, especially since we take six different models that include both non-hydrostatic and hydrostatic models, and we don't really expect them to be have that many similarities that would manifest themselves in this correlation. And yeah, I don't think there's a reason to believe that this would be solely from imperfect realizations of reality. But to definitively say that it's a genuine reflection of reality, then it would probably be best to use observational data and it'll be great to have less than 4 kilometer resolution observational data over a large ocean, but we can only hope.
Okay, so if there's no more questions, then many thanks for the presentation. And our next speaker is going to be Norbert Drieger with the evaluation of optical flow methods for radar precipitation extrapolation. And I see your screen there.
Well, hello. Thank you for joining this session. And I'd like to acknowledge my co-authors. First, Ahmed Mahijaba. He leads the radar operations team at CMC, at Environment and Climate Change Canada. And they process radar data on a 24/7 basis. Ahmed's group provides the source of data for this study. He's also a client of the results of this study in the function of directing products to users. And next, Andres Perez Ortal. He has worked on the inside of the PiSTEPS project, which I'll describe in a minute, for several years. He coded the variational echo tracking, or VET module, while still a McGill student. And as an ECC postdoc, he investigated the utility of methods described here for input into the GEM model data simulation. So I'll jump right in with a picture to introduce the study. Ahmed's group provides North American radar composites every 10 minutes. To keep it short, I'll focus on the BALTRAD data set, which is designed for data simulation purposes. It has a nominal pixel resolution of 2.5 kilometers, and the total size per image is almost 6 megapixels. We produce a 2-hour nowcast with a 10-minute time step. So for the animated images in this presentation, you'll see a radar coverage mask indicating observations, followed by non-masked images indicating the nowcast. Each sequence includes 6 observations and 12 forecast times. In other words, 1 hour of radar reflectivity observations and 2 hours of forecast. PiSTEPS is an open source Python package containing a variety of nowcasting and verification methods. Optical flow broadly refers to the computation of a difference field of or motion vectors between 2 or more consecutive images. And the go-to method out of the box in PiSTEPS is the Lucas-Conaday method. as implemented in the OpenCV computer vision library. And that's what I'm showing here. Here is the same image animation zoomed onto the Great Lakes. So there are well-known limitations of radar extrapolation. It's not NWP, although it generally scores better than NWP in the first few time steps. Ideally, we'd like to be blending extrapolation with NWP, easier said than done, at high resolution. Growth and decay may or may not be modeled. Here we do not. Keep in mind that a good first guess extrapolation can be used later as a predictor in AI or other methods. But a common problem we notice sometimes with extrapolation is if stationary things do not stay stationary. Lake effect snow anchored to a lake is a classic example. And sure enough, with Lucas Conaday, this happens. So in this example, we also get to see some clutter around Green Bay advected into Lake Michigan. And this serves as a good visual indicator of how much we are off in terms of keeping stationary things stationary. PiSteps comes with some methods built in. I also connected a few more like TVL1 and Brox. Brox especially is used in various meteorological centers, although the implementation may vary. I computed fraction skill scores for each using a threshold of 10 dBZ and a 5x5 pixel neighborhood window. It's a spatial score, less prone to double penalty. And since to a large extent we are measuring advection error, I also computed the displacement amplitude score. And this one involves morphing a forecast image to an observed image at each time step and then computing the difference. I'll provide a reference for that at the end because I coded this up myself. Then since time is of the essence and now casting, computational processing time was also considered. All methods produced respectable results, even surpassing Lucas Conaday in later time steps for this case. VET took the longest to run, although to be fair, an upscaled version of VET produced a good result in only 36 seconds total. So here I'll just show you, have a look at that. But having a good score doesn't necessarily translate to good visual realism. If you look at the top left with TVL1, it's pretty good at keeping stationary things stationary, but it deforms the lake effect snow east of Lake Superior. Rocks and darts are very similar to each other. For this case, moving features more southward than we'd like. Darts is a go-to method for some of our projects because it's fast and robust, just may not always be optimal. And I show the VET upscaled result instead of raw VET because it really doesn't look too bad. It's better than Lucas Conaday, but it still has some clutter motion. It might have been considered if not for better results later. So enter the Farnback smooth method. I developed this after playing with the Farnback method found in OpenCV, computer vision library. If we take Farnback as is out of the box, it produces motion vectors, but advection results in dissipating features. So one way to solve this is with Gaussian smoothing, which is a fast operation. That's good. The result isn't perfect, but it's reasonable, visually better than Lucas Conaday. There's a bit of clutter advection, but not terrible. Here are the charts for this comparison. So for this case, at least being very similar to Lucas Conaday, which is good. But the main takeaway is it's much faster to compute, less than half the time of what it takes to compute Lucas Conaday. Keep in mind too, from the previous slide, that Farnback smoothed keeps stationary things stationary better than Lucas Conaday. So far, we have no automated way of identifying lake effect snows, so we have to visually inspect this kind of performance for such cases. But separately, Andres did a study on the whole summer of 2019, running the methods shown, including Lucas Conaday and Farnback Smooth, generating 2-hour forecasts every 30 minutes and then verifying with a critical skill index. So this was good confirmation of previous results, keeping in mind that seasonal statistics tend to wash out severe events. But the exercise was also useful from the point of view of a code review for me. Andres made an interesting suggestion, which was to smoothen time as well as space. So 3 input times could be averaged to 2, and this improved the result and even sped up the timing slightly. More on this in a moment. But meanwhile, I was trying something else. So you may have heard that persistence is hard to beat in the short term. Well, similarly, error should persist early on. So the idea was to measure displacement error from the previous run, assume it persists, and then subtract it from the motion vectors of the current run. So there's some marginal improvement in doing this at not too great a cost. In fact, for these tests, rather than use a saved result from the previous run, it just recalculated and applied it to the current run. So for this case, the improvement can be seen visually in the Sault Ste. Marie area near the junction of the three lakes. The orange line marks the line of limit of movement for the snow in that area as calculated by the regular Farnback Smooth. And the error correcting version stops a bit short of that mark as hoped for. And here are the stats charts for the different Farnback Smooth versions just talked about. Smoothing in time, as suggested by Andre, speeds up the process time slightly and produces a slightly better result. Time smoothing is therefore incorporated into the error correcting version as well. This produces the leading result for this case, still in good time, even with recalculating the previous 10-minute now cast as opposed to storing it. Well, this is a good result, but we shouldn't overhype it, considering that at the end of the day, it is still just extrapolation, not in the same league as rapid update NWP. NWP has a way of looking realistic, even if it's not quite right. No forecast is going to be perfect. At 2.5 millimeter resolution, we are past the limits of predictability of small scales, but NWP and extrapolation forecasts amount to a suggestion of reality or a proposed scenario. And it leads to philosophical questions about realistic versus non-realistic representation of events, and how best to represent a complex probabilistic set of objects to the users of this data. So efficiency of communication becomes an issue. So this all being said, besides Baltrad, we produce a 1 kilometer resolution composite for a domain the size of North America. Image sizes approach 40 megapixels each, and we anticipate the update cycle to increase to every 6 minutes in line with our S-band radar network. In Canada, the absence of rapid update NWP for large areas of the country, it raises the question that maybe extrapolation will be the best we can do for at least the first hour. So contemplating release to the public, can we explain all the caveats effectively? So in conclusion, we've presented a novel method of optical flow that it's not yet found in a regular PI steps package. It's called Farnback Smooth. It's compatible with PySteps, and it's competitive with several known optical flow methods. It's relatively fast to compute, which makes it suitable for use with large North American grids. An error correcting version of Farnback Smooth was also presented with marginal improvements. So the original Farnback Smooth method, it's being run 24/7 at the Canadian Meteorological Center, CMC, to test robustness and gather internal feedback. But feedback from the meteorological community at large is welcome, including thoughts about making this product public. I include here a notable reference for the displacement and amplitude score, which may not be widely familiar to everyone. And I also want to acknowledge some comments on smoothing by my colleague Dominic Jacques, which partly inspired early developments on Farnback Smooth. And that's it. I'm happy to take any questions.
All right, many thanks. Yeah, you're just on time. We have about 2 minutes for questions if anyone has one.
Great.
Okay, so we have one in the chat here. I'll read it off. New AI, deep learning, now casting methods from Google or DeepMind use optical flow from PySteps as a baseline. Any thoughts on how using a better optical flow version improve accuracy versus using AI?
Well, it's extra information. I think if assuming it's a reasonably good starting point, it should provide extra context and hopefully it does improve the end result. I know in a lot of cases they do, just use AI as a neural network method only. We haven't tried it, but I can only speculate. We within PySteps there is a method for a growth and decay model, which we have tried. It's not a neural network, but it does show some improvement. But then you get into the question of is it worthwhile in the time you have available.
All right. And I'll just ask one more quick question. Is PySteps already parallelized, or is that something that you could do to make it a bit quicker?
Right, good question. Yeah, none of this was done with parallel processing. But yes, I to my knowledge, it's not within PySteps. Just out of the box, I don't think they have a parallelized aspect to it. I did some experiments of my own with parallelization, and it got tricky with all the edge effects. So my thinking is that it's probably not. Not done a lot.
All right.
If you're doing like an ensemble or something, then yes, for sure.
Yeah. I was just thinking like for a large domain like North America, you could probably cut it into quarters and maybe run each quarter.
Well, yeah. And certainly for a lot of problems, you would just work with small domains anyway.
Yeah.
It's just for this particular case, we're using the whole thing. So.
All right, so many thanks for that.
I'll stop sharing.
Yep, so then we're going to switch to our final speaker for the session, which is Chris Subic. And look, there's a screen share. So away you go, Chris.
Ah, there's my mute button. Greetings, I'm here today to have perhaps the most numerical numerical PDE's talk of the session, and that's on preconditioning a discontinuous Galerkin solver for the shallow water equations. Now, this is a very preliminary talk in that this work is still ongoing, and to spoil the conclusion is going to be that a lot more work's needed. So just as basic background, the Euler equations are the fundamental equations of atmospheric dynamics and weather forecasting. Solving them on the sphere is hard. They're nonlinear. They're a three-dimensional set system of equations. Spherical geometry adds its own wrinkles. And it has been the challenge of numerical weather forecasting for these many decades. Environment Canada is investigating new discretizations for its next generation dynamical core in blank number of years. The primary goal is to take advantage of up-and-coming supercomputer architectures, mainly GPU-type accelerators. One aspect of this is to make sure that our dynamical cores can support a large time step. That is a basic precondition of computational efficiency. Doubling the time step, all other things equal, halves the amount of work, means you can compute double the forecast per hour. And like I said, this presentation is baby steps towards that goal. These are the three-dimensional Euler equations as formulated in a lovely paper by Girard. This includes a couple of approximations, but otherwise is has spherical geometry. Most importantly, these equations support a whole bunch of different waves. That's sound waves and Rossby waves and gravity waves, and depending on how you define it, a couple of other modes. Sound waves tend to be very, very fast, and that limits traditional explicit time-stepping algorithms, and hence why the Environment Canada model, along with the vast majority of models in operational deployment worldwide, use some kind of implicit formulation. We can simplify this to the shallow water equations for the purposes of developing numerical methods. That eliminates sound waves and all vertical motion, but it retains gravity waves, and it contains advection, and it retains Rossby waves. These are a reasonable physical approximation of the Euler equations for very large scale hydrostatic flow. It's still a hyperbolic partial differential system of partial differential equations, and it's a standard test for new numerical methods. If a new numerical method doesn't do well in the shallow water equations, it's probably not worth implementing for the Euler equations. Now, to discretize this in time, the central objective is to permit long time steps. Doing so accurately anymore mostly means a higher order method. At least second order, ideally better, because that governs the error for the largest and slowest Rossby waves that drive weather over the long term. Long time steps means, in terms of advection, single-digit horizontal current numbers, where flow in the jet stream can move more than one grid point per time step. In terms of physical dimensions, that translates to 1 to 10 minutes, depending on resolution. And this is more important than just the dynamical core, because physical parameterizations tend to run per time step, and those are also very expensive. Now, the approach here, as I mentioned, was a fully implicit time stepper, where the basic form is that at each time step, an implicit equation is solved where everything is written in terms of the new time step plus forcing. The exact structure varies based on the underlying method, like a diagonally implicit Runge cutter or a multi-step method, but the basic functional form is the same. And the nonlinear solve implied in this, in turn, depends on a fast linear solve. So, how do we solve a linear implicit problem very well? Now, the other half of this is a spatial discretization. The discretization we're investigating in Environment Canada is a discontinuous Galerkin form called flux reconstruction. Now, discontinuous Galerkin methods divide the globe up into a whole bunch of elements that contain many points inside. Inside each element, the primitive variables are evaluated at high order with Lagrange interpolating polynomials, but the solution is allowed to be discontinuous between these elements. Communication happens between the elements through flux terms. This sort of discretization has tremendously great computational properties because almost all of the computation is local, requiring very little communication. And it is very flexible in terms of geometry as well. The variant here is called flux reconstruction, where the primitive variables are discretized at nodes, and the flux is made continuous by solving a the boundary problem with a Riemann solver at a higher order, and then the derivative is taken back to the computational modes inside each element. It has a natural extension to equations written in conservation form and the reference here, and at the end we'll describe the computations in more nitty-gritty detail. As a rough schematic, here is a function which we may wish to solve a linear advection problem on, f of t plus f of x is equal to zero. Within each of these three elements, f is discretized with cubic polynomials, but there are arbitrarily large jumps between adjacent elements. If you zoom in on the right, you can see here there's a gap at the element boundary between the element on the left, which comes in at about 4.5, and the element on the right, which comes in a little bit over 1/2. Now, the flux term here is just upwinding, and that picks one of these solutions, the upwind solution, and says this is the flux here, and the flux is now continuous across the element. It still has a discontinuous derivative, but the flux itself is continuous, which allows which preserves conservation properties. Back on the full view, this is what it looks like. Again, it's roughly what you would expect for f of t plus f of x is equal to zero. Now, when you take the derivative, you get this, which is discontinuous again at the element nodes because you've taken the derivative of something that has discontinuous derivatives, but the aliasing error is eliminated at the nodal points because when they're located at Gauss quadrature points, and it tends to behave very nicely as a computational core for the numerical PDE. Now, in one dimension, the shallow water equation is reduced to this pair of equations for when linearized about a mean current and a mean background state. This is approximately what a single step of Newton's method would look like, although the U-naught and phi-naught might be variable in time. This is time discretized using a backwards Euler method. Again, it's a basic functional form. But how do we solve this? The underlying computational assumption of an element-based method is that everything you do within an element is really, really fast, almost free, but then communication takes an age. So the natural division here is to do this solution in two steps. The first is solve each independent element independently with some kind of locally implicit solve, and then you correct in an outer iteration by computing new boundary fluxes, and then you iterate and hopefully the residual goes to zero. If you do that, this is your convergence rate depending on the Courant number. For Courant numbers much below one, this is wonderful and you gain 1 to 3 digits of accuracy per iteration. The graph here just involves graphing many different Froude numbers at the same time on the same plot. But for the area of interest with larger Courant numbers, the convergence is rather poor. This makes a bit of intuitive sense because when you solve one element at a time and you correct with boundary fluxes at each iteration, it means that each iteration you can convey information no further than one element. If you want better convergence, then you need some kind of long-range communication. That can be accomplished through multigrid. The local solver of solving each element independently instead of being a preconditioner by itself is an error smoother, which reduces the high wave number components of the error. And then the geometric multigrid adds additional operators. One is a coarsening or a restriction operator, which projects the residual onto a coarse grid. The second operator is a coarse grid solve, which is usually some kind of recursive multigrid cycle. And the third operator is a fine grid interpolation operator, which projects the coarse grid solution back onto the fine grid. A multigrid V cycle does one or more smoothing steps of the error, then takes the error, projects it onto the coarse grid, solves the solution there, and takes the solution and interpolates it back to the fine grid, and then finally has a couple post-smoothing steps of the error. If you do that, defining these operators is fairly straightforward. In the interest of time, I'll gloss over this because since we have a polynomial basis, projecting onto coarse elements just involves projecting onto coarse modes. And then when you run out of coarse modes, you can combine elements. In 1D, this converges absolutely wonderfully. Up to Courant numbers of about 10, the maximum eigenvalue, you gain about 2 digits of accuracy per iteration, which is a wonderfully fast rate. Now, in 2 dimensions, everything that I've described applies very nicely by a tensor product. The linearized advection involves advecting with u with respect to u and v, and then the u and v velocities depend on the x and y derivatives of phi respectively. The flux across the 2-dimensional element boundaries can be solved with by applying the 1-dimensional Riemann solver. And again, it's the same kind of solver or upwinding. The multigrid operator is also defined in a pretty straightforward way with respect to the tensor product. If you have a 2-dimensional space of polynomial modes, then your coarse modes are the lowest half in x and y, and you can project onto that. However, when you do so, the convergence is quite a bit worse. For advection only, you end up with a convergence rate of the multigrid operator that depends strongly on the Courant number. Here, a Courant number of 10 will get you roughly half to a third of a digit per iteration. This arises because coarsing in 2D coarsens in X and Y together, but advection in even in 2D is along lines. So if you imagine that the velocity is in U only, then the solution moves in U only. But when you coarsen along Y, then you are mixing together what are independent streamlines. This isn't fatal for convergence. It doesn't result in an unstable method, but it's not nice. Now, it's okay at moderate Courant numbers because you can advect one element at a time with reasonable accuracy, but it's imperfect. The worst case, though, is when you return to the full shallow water equations, and even without advection with the zero background velocity, convergence decays very, very badly. Here at a Courant number of about 1, you have the half digit per iteration, and this is probably too slow for a full numerical solver. This is not a problem of one-dimensional characteristics, because if you rearrange the shallow water equations, you end up with a diffusion equation for phi. The problem is that not all the modes are gravity waves, and this is where the current state of the art is not terribly happy. The worst eigenmode here of this iteration looks like this plot. This is a plot of the local vorticity with the arrows representing the velocities corresponding to that worst mode. The worst mode, the one that converges most slowly, consists of corner vortices, where at each corner of the element, there is a positive or negative vortex. From the perspective of the shallow water equations, this is just fine. There's almost no gravity wave component to this, and with no background flow, the shallow water equations are just happy to preserve this mode. But from the perspective of each element, from the perspective of each element, a whole bunch of stuff is flowing into or out of the element, and the smoother generates a whole bunch of spurious gravity waves, which are not what really happens, and that leads to the poor convergence. And this is where I must conclude and say that this is still very much work in progress. I think that there is a way to get to a better converging model from here, but it is going to involve a more intricate smoother. One possibility will be to construct supplemental continuous modes to explicitly model these corner vortices. Another might be to replace the full coarsening with semi-coarsening by solving the problem in X first and then solving the problem in Y, reducing the 2D system to a set of 1D solvers effectively. And a third approach might be to have a global smoother and just give up on the per element smoothing. This is not really a problem of the shallow water equations themselves. It's a problem with the way this interacts with the discretization. And I hope to come back in the future with significantly more encouraging results. But in the meantime, the references I began, and I can take questions.
All right, so thanks, Chris. We have one question in the chat. which is any thoughts or work on solving the equations on GPUs?
Oh, all right. The thought of solving this on the GPU has been in my mind this entire time. That's the basis for my assertion that everything you do on an element is fast and everything that crosses an element boundary is slow. In 2D, even the memory bandwidth use of solving stuff on an element is not too bad. If in 3D, it gets a little more intricate, but I believe it's still reasonable. Already, the Environment Canada forecasts that run on just CPUs show some strong scaling impacts versus number of nodes. I mean, the MPI communication costs are, yeah, they are the dominant factor determining the scalability of the weather models that are run today. We are unlikely to be able to buy a supercomputer 10 years from now that is not fundamentally GPU based or the like for a large part of its computational output. So, and that will make the difference between computation and communication even stronger. Furthermore, the discontinuous Galerkin method, since everything reduces to an element, is better suited for the idea of doing the same thing to a bunch of different elements within the confines of a single GPU versus something like a semi-Lagrangian method where the interpolation stencils vary from point to point and time to time, and it is a little trickier to implement on the GPU.
All right, so do we have any more questions?
I will stop sharing my screen then.
All right. So thanks very much, Chris. And thanks to all our other speakers today.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much, everyone who was at this session. This was like in previous years, this was a wonderful session. And I am happy to see so many different numerical and computational disciplines come together here at CMOS. I believe now our gracious CMOS volunteer can